Yeah, so this is a training about branding, and we are here today with Santiago and Johanna from, is it Johanna or Joanna? Johanna.
Johanna.
Johanna, mixture of the two. Johanna, Santi's from Camp Jaguar Siembra in Colombia, and Johanna is from Sinal de Vale, which I was calling Sinal de Val, and I was saying it wrong, in Brazil. And the two of them are selling products from their projects that are helping them finance their restoration work. So they are both here today to share the stories and the journeys of how those brands were created. And we will begin with Santi. So Santi, take it away.
So hello, everyone. Thank you very much for the invitation and for being here. As Ashley say, I'm from Colombia, and we are working in a special site that is the Sierra Nevada de Santa Marta. It is the biggest coastal mountain by the sea in the world, and it's a really unique ecosystem because it goes from the ocean to the snow in only one place. It has all the thermal floors, and it's said that it's the most irreplaceable biodiversity place in the world. When the conquest arrived, the indigenous communities that were living there went up into the mountain, and they have been preserved for thousands of years, living in a really special connection with nature. They call themselves the elder brothers, and they call ourselves the younger brothers. And they call that place the heart of the world. It's proven that there is a ecosystem there in the Caribbean, that everything that happens there affects the rest of the ecosystem in a bigger scale. So these communities, right now they are open to us, and they want to teach us a lot of things about our relationship with nature. And we've been working for them for 5 years. Actually, I'm a filmmaker, I'm a photographer, and I started the project as a documentary, as a transmedia project. Then I was studying permaculture, and I started to planting trees. We are focused in agroforestry, that actually is the traditional sowing systems that the communities have been using for thousands of years. So the problem there was the coca plantations, the wheat plantations, and the conflict, the forest, 80% of the Sierra. And 30 years ago, 20 years ago, the communities have been, recovering the land. They do natural reservations. They do a lot of restorations with different methods, like quartz planting and gold planting, and yeah, different types of things that actually we don't use too much, but they are focused on that. And the thing is that at the same time that they are recovering the lands, the soils are really damaged. So we started working with regenerative agriculture to recovering the soils. We are focusing into growing cacao, but the communities adopted coffee 100 years ago when the one Spanish cappuccino mission from the church went there and bring the seeds of the coffee. And the communities start realizing that actually the younger brother likes too much coffee, and the younger brother pays a lot for the coffee. So they adopt the plant. They do a lot of rituals to adopt the plant in their territory. And they've been growing coffee from actually 100 years already. So coffee is one of the reasons why deforestation stopped. And right now is one of the main incomes that the communities had. Cacao is native from there, and it's really special. We are focusing in both. But last year we started with a project that is called Coffee for Biodiversity. So we started with the project. We are working with 60 families that are in just one town. It's a single origin coffee. And these coffees grow by them with the moon cycles, with the star cycles. They have a lot of rituals before the sowings. They had a lot of, they call it payments. So payments to the air to grow the things, to harvest the things. And they have a really special project, a process with food. So in long story short, their message is that taking care of nature is actually really easy. Like if we change the way that we consume food, everything is gonna be like a wave into how to taking care good of nature. And of course, producing and consuming are interconnected. So we started with this project. This project allows us to pay the operational cost of the foundation, to support the families, and at the same time, regenerate the land. We are working with community-supported agriculture. So we are a community that pre-buy the coffee with a monthly subscription. So the people that want to join pre-buy the share of the harvest, and we deliver it monthly. So that creates more resilience for the farmers and for everyone that is involved in the project, because coffee is part of the trading system that is regulated by the stock market. So in that way, we are not participating in the stock market. And yeah, here I'm going to start with the presentation. So I'm going to share the screen, but I don't know how, Ash.
In the bar below, there's this green button that says share screen.
I see. Yeah, actually, yeah, it's there. So now you can see it.
Yeah, we can see it. If you make it full screen.
I'm trying.
Uh-huh. Cool.
But how do I make it more?
And then in the okay.
The bottom, there's this, that one.
Okay, we have it, okay.
Okay, so here is our logo, and I would love to start there because I think it was the first branding and image that we create. As I come from the arts and from filmmaking and from all this background, we wanted to have all the elements that represent the project. The jaguar is the father of the forest, and if there is no jaguars in Latin America, the forest is not healthy and is going to die. And the jaguar has a really deep relationship with the indigenous communities. It's seen as the energy force of the earth, and it's the regulator of all the ecosystem. So our project is called Jaguar Siembra, that is means the jaguar that is sowing. I don't know if that's the exact translation, but yeah. And we focus in natural and cultural projects. So we started with this, and we wanted to have all the representation of the project there. So as you see, there is a seed here. The triangle is the Sierra, that is the moonshine, is the moon and the sun. Is the circular, the circle that engage and hold like the earth and all of us together. The circle is really important in indigenous communities too. For example, their houses are circular. You sit in the circle to start to talking and to discussing these things. So they have four worlds. So the four worlds are represented in the middle of the eye, that is the eye of the consciousness. There is the jaguar there, and yeah, like we wanted to have all of this in the logo, and we create that. And of course, this is based on semiotic and semiological things, but then you have a result. There is something kind of simple that the people can engage, and the people do not need to understand all of that background. But the image is gonna attract the people already. And that meanings that we have there are gonna be enclosed in the people, even if we cannot understand it so good. So this was the first part. Then when we wanted to start with the coffee project, I think that the first thing that we need to ask ourselves when we are going to start a project is why. Because of course the reason that the why of most people is to have an income, to create resilience, to sell something, or is kind of the same, the main goal of all of these projects. But we need to go deeper into that, because if we go deeper into that questions, we are going to start to finding some answers that are going to be really important for the development of the message and the branding that we want to share. The branding, personally for me, is actually the message that we want to communicate to the, not the customers, but all of the people that are going to see the project. So the branding is the image way to communicate the message from the project. And for us, like for example, for the indigenous communities, the reason why I start with the coffee is because they see the coffee as a messenger. So they are actually not interested in the money. The money is something important. Yes, it's going to create resilience. It's going to create an income. But for them, the coffee is a messenger from the heart of the world to the heart of the people that are taking that food. So this is the main reason why they want to start the project. So they say that every time that we are consuming a food, we are connecting ourselves directly with the territory. So I think Seb is having a call or something like that. If you can please mute your microphone.
Who's that? Okay.
Yeah. Cool.
Ringtone, Seb.
Yeah. Okay. So, and it's like every time that we are consuming a food, we are connecting with that territory. So if we are consuming a Colombian coffee, we are connecting with Colombian territory, with the soil, with the biodiversity that is around there, with the people that grow it. In a more deeper sense, it's like we have in a relationship with our body and with nature itself. So this is the why that they wanted to create this project. So we started to talking with them and to see, yeah, what is the best way to call the project? And they right away say, this is coffee for biodiversity. So this is coffee for the preservation of biodiversity. And then they start to arise the message that they wanted to share. It's like the connection that we have with food, how we can change things through food to have a healthy and to make peace with nature. They call it like that. Like they call it like, we can make peace with nature through food, to eating organic food, to farming good, and to creating good trade systems and so on. So that was the first part. And then we started to encounter the problems. So we are living in the coffee is a neo-colonial, I don't know how to say it in English, but neo-colonization is like a neo-colonized product that has not changed the trading from hundreds of years. It's an industry that is built in exploitation, as the same as cacao. And the farmers, 50% of the farmers are living, of coffee farmers in Colombia, are living in poverty, and they are giving up the coffee plantations. That creates, like, the women are more susceptible. Sorry if I don't speak so good English. I have a confuse of languages in my mind. But yeah, it's a problem for the women too. And then the people that are growing, that are not growing coffee, then they start to grow coca and they change to illicit crops. And it's a wave of so many things and social and cultural things that are really bad. The coffee farmers never see a profit, like the profits are always in the northern countries. There is a study that says that the people that trade coffee have a profit of 200% of every kilo that they are buying. The coffee commodity is has created a lot of monocultures to supply the demand of the northern countries. So, and the price is regulated by the stock market and is like, for example, 1 euro a pound, or sometimes even 1 euro a kilo. Here in Europe, we can take a cup of coffee for 3 euros and it's 10 grams. So you can calculate how many is that this balance. Right now we have sales that are fair trade, Rainforest Alliance, all that things. But all that sales only guarantee that you pay 20 cents more or even 1 euro more for the coffee that you are buying. And that's actually not changing too much. It's helping because the people are more aware of the things that are buying, but it's a long way to create equity in this commodity at the same as cacao and other ones. So this is our why we wanted to start the project, as we are based here in Vienna and we wanted to share that message from the communities. We wanted to start a conversation with the coffee industry too. Yeah, we could grow coffee in harmony with nature, but we can trade it good too. And we can share the profits from here to there. We are a nonprofit, so all of our profits are going back into the place of origin. And in that way, we can change a lot of things. So it's something about to start to having a conversation. And if they consume change here in Europe or in United States or in Australia, then southern countries are gonna start to have a revival. We are not gonna deforest more to grow these type of crops. The families are gonna create resilience, and we are gonna find a way that if the coffee industry and the cacao industry change, wow, imagine how many hectares of regenerative agriculture, how many things are gonna change, because is the second commodity in the world. So it's a 2 billion industry, more than two, I escaped the number, but it's really big. 200 billones, 200 mil billones de euros. That's something really that even that amount of money in my head doesn't fit. So this is why we wanted to start the project, and we say like, okay, this is the message that we want to share, but we need to share it with love, because if we are gonna start to attack everything, it's a vicious cycle. And yeah, the best way to create it is that, yeah, coffee for biodiversity is good for you and it's good for the planet. Then the second thing is actually the research. All of this is based in a research. I'm coming from Colombia and we are really famous to growing coffee, but actually we don't drink so much good coffee, because most of the coffee that is good is going outside of the country and we don't have a coffee culture. I start to understand about coffee here in Europe that the roaster and the people are more involved in the notes, the scales, how it's processed, how it's a lot of technical stuff that is really incredible. So it was a long research. Actually, when I was studying permaculture, I make a pilot of an agroforestry hectare with coffee. And since then we wanted to do this. So then we found a community that was already growing coffee. We started working with them and we started to investigate, okay, what is a specialty coffee? Because, for example, we are in the specialty coffee. Coffee has a scale from 1 to 100, and the coffees that are above 80, that are organic coffees and so on, is called a specialty coffee. The rest of the coffee is commodity coffee. The coffee that we usually drink in the supermarket is 60 points, between 60, 50, 70 points. And of course, it's more cheaper to trade. There are only three big companies that are buying 50% of the coffee harvest of the world. And that 50% of the coffee harvest of the world are produced by small farmers. So in the small farmers, we already know that 70% of the food that we consume is created by small farmers. So this is why it's really important to start to uplift the farmers, to step to changing that consume. And we noticed that, of course, there is a lot of new boom with the specialty coffee. The new generations are really involved in that, in how their consume habits are having an impact of the planet. And yeah, that was our why and our research on how to start the project. Then we already have a clarity of what we wanted to do, but there's always the question, how I'm going to do that? And we are living in an era that everything is around image, and with the image you can create a lot of good things and you can share a lot of good messages, and the image is really important. So the I don't know, Nespresso invests thousands of euros into their campaigns and to the packaging, all that stuff. But as a person that comes from the arts, we don't need all of that to create something beautiful and something that creates impact. So for example, all of our branding on all of our image was using a permaculture principle that is, with the less amount of energy, let's create the most amount of energy. So it's the way that nature works, and we are applying all of our processes. So the first recommendation that I have to you, and the first thing that we did and everyone needs to do when we are building a brand, is creating a mood board. A mood board is simple, a collection of images of other projects, other brands that you feel attracted. So I made this one. So for example, we started to see, I like really these colors. I love how the way they use the typography here. This is the communities that we work. This is something that our designer that makes the project did. So we have it as a reference for ourselves. How do nature is interconnected with coffee? In the beginning we wanted to have the Jaguar, so we found this monkey in a project, and it was really good. And we started to make this mood board, and from this mood board, everything is going to start to take more shape. So then you need to combine two things that are really important. Yeah, the message that you want to share and the things that you like. Yeah. And the problems that you have. So for example, I started in the research that we did, even with the indigenous brands that they already sell coffee or something like that, we found that there was a lack of representation of who was the indigenous communities. So they have beautiful packages with nice typographic or something like that, but the people doesn't know who are the Arhuacos. The Arhuacos are this tribe that are here. They have the traditional dress. Here is the mochila, as you can see. This hat represents the snow of the mountains. The mochila is made by the women and represent is a way to carry the earth with us. And we found that, this is something that we need to include in our packaging, because it needs to be there for the people to realize who are the people that are growing this. So for example, if your project is focused in women, it would be great that the image needs to be a woman and needs to have the elements that represent the ideas that you want to share. So we make this and then we went to a phase of drafts. And I wanted to explain something that everything that we are doing in our process is more a journey than a destination. Right now, actually, we are working in our third packages, our third packaging. So on. So we are rebranding the project every time that we release a new harvest. And I think that some brands, they just make one thing and it's okay, it works for years. But we wanted to include art. So our idea is that every year we are working with a different artist to create some different piece of art for the packaging. And yeah, it's something that is going to evolve and changing over the time. So the first two elements that we say, like, okay, we need to have the community and we need to have the Jaguar. Then we started with the draft. This draft, it was the first draft that we made. And then it evolutes. We make the evolution to this one. Yeah, as you can notice, the Jaguar is a little bit different. Here, the Jaguar is more like a cat, or it's not so much a Jaguar. Here is more a Jaguar. So in these little details are a lot of things. We found that, yeah, we need to include the ocean and the snow mountains, and that's a representation of the place. It goes from the ocean to the snow mountains, and here is the plant of coffee. Something that I found that is really interesting is that in the northern countries, most of the people that consume coffee or cacao, they don't know how that plant looks. So they don't know how a plant of coffee looks, or even a cacao plant looks. They don't know. It's like, and they don't know the process from the farm to the cup. So that is another why. Okay, it's another message that we need to start to talk about it to the people. We notice the disconnection that we have with our food there. Like, we don't know even the food that we are consuming. Where are the plants, or who are the plants that are producing that food? So it's something that we really want to get deep on that. So then we create this final draft that is here. So we evolved the Arhuaco because it was looking, yeah, a little bit different. Actually, the indigenous communities in the Sierra, they are really Asian look. They are really, it's really incredible. They are really, when you see them, it's like a really deep connection with Asia. So it's for me, it's really fascinating. And then we started to evolve into this, yeah? The hair, the long hair is a representation of the hair is our antennas for the earth. So it's the way that our thoughts or energy is there in the hair. Is something, this is why we men, as we are in the communities, we use it, the long hair. When the Spanish conquest arrived, it was the first thing that they started to do it with the men. They cut the hair, and that created like a disconnection and less power. So the Sansón history and all of that, it has something about something true. And we need to revive all that traditions. So we made this, and with this, we released our first coffee. That this was the first presentation that we have after the research, the ideas that we have, and of course, the simplification of that ideas. We cannot include everything that we want, but we started with this. I recommend always that less is more. Like in image, less is more. You don't need to put a lot of elements or to have 11 colors or something like that. If you notice, and if you go to a supermarket, that's a good exercise. Go to the supermarket and go to the places and start to look in the packaging and start to look in, yeah, what is the packaging that you feel more attracted? What are the things that you like it from that? So in that exercise, I found that even here, there was a roasting that was already selling this type of coffee from the indigenous communities, from other ones, and they were selling it in the name of Cristobal Colón. So we have a fight and a discussion with them because they were selling an indigenous product with a name of a genocider. So it was really bad, and they were selling it really good because the concept of them is pirates coffee. So of course, Cristobal Colón was a great pirate, and they create all of their marketing in that. And I was, I arrived and I was like, yeah, you know who are growing these coffees, indigenous communities? Yeah, yeah. But you know who was Cristobal Colón? And they, the first thing that they told me, yeah, the picture is not so good, but we are working in the packaging. I was like, yeah, no, it's not about the picture. It's about that, as I see it, is like if you are selling a Hitler coffee or something like that. So you need to do a good research before to put in something like that, because you are selling an indigenous coffee with the name, with a person that kills millions of indigenous. So then they retire the coffee and they change it. Right now they are not selling it more, sadly. But yeah, that was something that happened, and it's something that it passed too often. Yeah. So big brands start to creating their marketing and the image with the wrong messages, and the people are buying that. So imagine if we could do the things good, and then it's gonna have a better way out. So we created this packaging. We created this element too, that it is included the history. And other thing that I noticed that it was a part of our focus is that we need to tell the story of the people that grow the coffee. And that's something that most of the coffee do not do. So they say, yeah, it's a fair trade coffee. It comes from Latin America. That's it. But you don't know, it's coming from the farm Pepita Perez, and that's it. So we did that, and here we tell a little bit of the story, and in the backside that I'm gonna show you here. So we put a QR code that the people can access to our website directly when they put their phones. So using technology, something really good. And then we create the story of the heart of the world. Why this place is the heart of the world, who are the communities that are growing, why the communities want to sell coffee. So Mamos says the coffee acts as a messenger, speaking directly from the hearts of the native people to ours, a bridge between worlds, a demonstration of how we can live in harmony with nature and cultivate the land without harming these fragile ecosystems, how it's truly possible to create regenerative organic cultures and circular economies. So you need to, every part of the packaging is a canvas. So it's really great to put all the information that you want there. And then the official things that you need to have, yeah? So for example, here in Austria, this needs to be in German. We make all of our communications in English. Our logos and more design based in the things that represent us, that as you can see, it is the Jaguar. The Jaguar is our main image that we want to share to the world. Then we received some feedback. So we released that and we received some feedback. The woman was not included. Yeah. And we start to talking with the community, and they have the same problem. Yeah. Like they have this discussion that the woman is always put it outside from a lot of things. So I don't know if you know Juan Valdez, but it's a really big brand around the world that is a farmer with a donkey, and it's really famous. Even in Hollywood, that brand has appeared. And in the beginning, we were focusing on, only one character, simplify everything. And then we started to change, because the women are really important. Actually, we work with a lot of women that are the leaders. And the message from the communities in the Sierra is that the future is lived by women. It's gonna be a woman lead. So the energy of the earth is a female energy. And even ourselves as men, we have it, a divine female energy. And we wanted to represent that in the packaging, two in the communications that we want to do. So in the beginning was a misunderstanding with the community, because for them, all of this process, we do it with, we always making it with the community. It's like we are gathering here, we are talking about the packaging, what we need to include, what we need to add. And in the first one, we commit the mistake to not include the woman for a lot of factors. We were in a rush, we wanted to release fast, we didn't have so many times. We can create a lot of excuses, but in the end, it was a mistake. So yeah, we need to come back again and start to doing everything and to include the woman. So we start to making a draft. As you can see here, this is the first idea that our designer sent us. And we always start to working with her. Yeah, let's create the waves a little bit more beautiful. Let's, we don't like this thing that she have here. I don't know, maybe she looks better here or she looks better here. So it's always something that is talking and talking and talking. Then we create this one, but the colors and the things, it was not the fit. And then we arrive to this one that is the last one. Yeah, so as you can see, the waves are really good here. We changed the name because the first one was another coffee, different from this one. This one is a single origin. It is put it here that is coffee for biodiversity, and Iku is the community that grows the coffee, is Arhuaco. And then we have it, the Jaguar, as a totem, but actually it's, yeah, a little evolution from the first design that we have. It's really good because in the beginning, everyone was really, wow, nice. The packaging looks nice and everything, but it was only a few people that, actually it was two persons only that say, it's like, it would be great if you can put the woman there too. And then these two voices become something really special. And yeah, we start to get in an evolution. This is, for example, the colored version. Yeah, you can see there is more detail. This is some posters that we print, that we paste into Vienna. And I think like coming back to this type of things is really good too. Like right now, everything is online. We put a Facebook ad or something like that. But traditional publicity is always going to be really good because most of the people buy coffee in the stores, not online. So we need to find a way to that the people that are walking in the street see the image, put the phone in the QR code and go to the website and realize that, yeah, this is something that I can buy only online. We don't have a store. Everything is just an online shop. And then we put it more bigger here, Coffee for Biodiversity, and our website, and yeah, a little improvements there. So from this, is something that we found that, yeah, it's really cool, it's really nice, but it's, in a personal opinion, it doesn't fully find myself really in the things that we wanted to do. So this year we change it again, and I'm gonna show a little bit of the process that we are doing. This is the final packaging that we have right now. I can show you here too. It's like, I don't know if you see it good there, but yeah, here contains the story. Here is the packaging, and this is kind of the first step that we make until December with the first part of the harvest. This packaging is not compostable, it's made by stickers too. And this is something that we wanted to change. Like we wanted to have every part of the process and every part of the project needs to be more alineated with the thing that we are doing. But a compostable packaging is more cheaper actually than a package like this. For example, these packages cost around €1. A compostable packaging cost 50 cents. But the thing is the amount of that you need to buy. So for the compostable packaging, we need to buy 10,000 already. And this, the coffee that we are producing is a micro lot, so it's no more than 2 tons. So we don't have the resources to do that investment, so we release it in this way. But the idea is to keep evolving, and this brings us to this year. So this year, this is in what we are working actually right now. Next month, we are going to release, we always release a crowdfunding where the people can pre-buy the harvest, or where the people can pre-buy the coffee consumption from the year. So if you drink 1 kilo coffee in a month, you can pre-buy your 12 kilos and we are going to send it to you every month. So we started to evolve again and start to include in more things that we felt that it was left. So Colombia is the second most biodiverse country in the world. We have the most amount of endemic birds. We have 40% of the country is jungle, and we are really known for nature, right? So we wanted to include more of that into the packaging to tell the story a little bit more clear. So this is the first trap that we make. And one of the things is that when the people see a Colombian coffee, they think in quality already. So that is kind of already established. So it's really good to find that things from your product that are already established to take advantage of that. So right now we are putting Colombia here, more bigger. Tairona is the name of the indigenous communities that it was there. Right now are the descendant that are 4 tribes and they have different names. So we wanted to revive that original name that actually is really famous because we have a natural park that is called Tairona, and it's visited for thousands of tourists a year. So we wanted to change, and we make a step back and we say like, okay, yeah, it's really cool to have the representation of the man of the woman, but we are always talking about, for example, the mamos that are the spiritual leaders, but not the sagas that are the women spiritual leaders. So we need to uplift this. And the way to uplift this is to create a space for that. And when we put together the man of the woman, yeah, it's a beautiful story, is humanity, is as we are, but right now we wanted to focus only into the power of the woman. And actually there, the woman has a really beautiful relationship with some plants. The woman is the only one that is allowed to grow it, is allowed to harvest. So for example, with the coca, the woman is the only one that is allowed to grow it and is the only one that is allowed to harvest. But the man is the only that is allowed to consume it. This has a deep reason. It's because the woman already have all that energy of the plant inside. And we as men, we need that plant to have that energy. So it's something really, really beautiful that I found. It's like these intersections into dependence of the genders into nature, into sowing, into the way that they see the world. So we wanted to evolve, then we evolved it to this draft. As you see, the lines are more clear. There in the community, there is a micro colibri that actually is as big as this. It's endemic from the area and it's really important for the communities. These animals appear, for example, when the harvest is ready. So they found this frog that is actually, they don't found it, the frog was always there. But last year, National Geographic went with the coffee community that we are working to photograph this frog that is here, that is a black frog with white dots that actually it creates light in the darkness. It's something really, really incredible and really beautiful. And this frog appears into the coffee, into the other plantations when the harvest is ready. So this is, they are really into connected into observing nature in every part of their life. So we wanted to include it as the same as the colibri because there are two animals that are really important. Then we wanted to include the house too because it's something really special. They say that, for example, the way that we are living always in houses that are in a square is something limiting for the energy. And this is why they live in circles. So it's like, this is why we have sometimes our thoughts in not so good direction, because it's like they are in a box or we are living in boxes and not in circles. And this is a really special place that is called Tejuna. It's our Machu Picchu. It's called Lost City. It's known as not as Lost City, and it's more older than Machu Picchu. It's a pyramid site in circles, and then we have it here, the snow peaks and the representation of the fauna. Yeah, the condor, the eagle, the a butterfly that it has 89 in their body. So the waves, and we are creating this to evolving. Right now, the women are gonna be like a Tairona woman before. They were dressed in gold. When the conquists arrived, they noticed that everyone of the community was dressed in gold. But gold for them, it is actually the spiritual material, is the most energy, is the best energy conductor on Earth, and it's a reason why gold needs to be underground, and why when we use gold as dressing or an offering, the most of the gold in the indigenous communities were used by artists or by craftsmen. So it was really important. And right now we want to create a Tairona saga, a Tairona wisdom woman dressed in gold. And this is the evolution that we have until now. We are going to release this next month with the crowdfunding campaign. And we are working to finish this. So maybe next month when we release the campaign, I'm gonna share it with you and you are gonna see the final result of what we are doing with the full color, with the compostable packaging, with the new messages that we want to create, with the video that is gonna be with the campaign, with the new infographic pieces. And then you are gonna see everything that I just talk more visually. And I think that is gonna be the next step. So you can go to our website, is jaguarsiembra.com. And then the release is gonna be the 22 of May, that is the Biodiversity Day. So I hope that it was helpful, but it was good for you to hear all of this story. I tried to do it the most simple way. And yeah, looking forward to see your projects and how they are evolving. If you need anything or if you want to go more deep into these concepts, just write me. I'm gonna put my email there into the chat and we can have a conversation. That would be awesome. So thank you very much. I think this is my part.
Thank you, Santi. That was amazing. Your brand is so beautiful. And I have some of the coffee at home and it's really yummy and tasty. It feels less intense than coffee that you buy in the supermarket. It doesn't give you the same like anxious, jittery feeling that the coffee in the mm-hmm. supermarket gives you. It's like a bit more gentle.
It's a soft coffee, yeah.
Yeah, which is really nice. So does anyone have any questions specifically about the branding part? I know I saw that Yasmin had some questions about packaging and marketing, but I just wanted to focus today on branding, because I think it was Johanna that said marketing and packaging are topics of their own that will take more time to discuss, and it's too much to talk about all of them in one session. So does anyone have any questions for Santi about creating his brand?
Yes, I have many questions. So you sell the coffee to the immediately, not through a distributor man, but straight to the store or straight to the consumer. Am I right?
Yeah, straight to the consumer. Actually, it's our donors. So we are building a small community that subscribe monthly, and is just to the consumers directly. With this coffee, it's really difficult to expand to the stores because it's a limited coffee. Actually, the community is called it natural edition. So it's not limited edition, but natural edition. So we don't have a big amount of coffee. We wanted to bring more coffee for different communities and then to start to go into the stores and something like that. But right now in the beginning, it's just directly to the consumer. Here, for example, I'm going to show a little bit of the website. This is our mm-hmm. website, and then you can, there is a video in the beginning that the people can have an idea of these communities, the nature that is around. These are special elements from the water to the houses to the community itself. And then we use a lot of illustrations to tell the story that we wanted to do. Like we mm-hmm. have a monthly program for, yeah, to take climate actions, then the things that we are doing, mm-hmm. the colibri, then a video and how it's work, how you can be involved. So you can donate monthly, or then you can be in the coffee club, or then you can create coffee forest. Then what is a food forest? Because most of the people they don't know what is a food forest. So we create an illustration to, you can grow all of these things together as the people do it before. Here we have coffee and here we have cacao. What is regenerative agriculture and what are the things that we can achieve with that? Here is the product, and then a shop that where the people can take single orders or subscriptions. So they can buy, for example, six month subscription or a yearly subscription. Mm-hmm. And this is the way that we do it, and it's the fact how we distribute the money, for example, how it costs, all the transparency that is really important to have it in all of these projects. What are the benefits? Why we are doing this? More images, like this is the communities that we are working. As you can see, they live really in harmony with nature.
Yes, Santiago, because what I think is that if I do not involve all the people around my community, we are like 1,200 people around, I mean, forest is not being protected. So you have to do some for them in order for them to have a good quality of life. I don't know what altitude you have, because I am at 920 meters high, which mm-hmm. is not much for the coffee, but we do have some coffee that they kill all the coffee because suddenly the cacao was the highest price. So everybody planted cacao. The cacao started to have illness and plagues and so, because monoculture is not what you should do in the forest. And they kill many of, for instance, we had castaña, the mm-hmm. almond. We were we had a lot of almond trees, and they cut them down totally because of the wood. No, but if you can make like a trade with people directly, I mean, they will have better amount of money from income, you know, and that's the only way to do it. Yeah. And do you link with, is this a movement around the world, or is just you that started this? Because I am interested in how to do it.
I think there is a lot of pool projects doing a lot of the same things. Actually, everything is based in community support agriculture. The problem with the farms is that they put a lot of money energy to grow something, and they don't know how to sell it. So they sell it really cheap to the first person that appear, that are cooperatives most of the time. And from that cooperative, sell it to the exporter, and from the exporter to the importer, and so on. So we need to change that and to create a direct relationship from the consumers to the farmers, and that create a deeper bond. So we started with one family, working with one family, and then we started to grow and grow. And that's the idea, that the people realize that, yeah, if I buy that coffee, I'm gonna pay it directly to the farmer, yeah? And I'm creating this, but you can research more as community supported agriculture.
I have a community supported agriculture.
Yeah, okay, in the 60s, it was a boom from that. It comes from earlier because it was the way that we trade food in the beginning, but. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it is evolving in so many different ways. So for example, in the States, the Black communities, they do it. In Japan, they did this a lot. So, and right now it's reviving. So even with the pandemic, we realized that, yeah, we need to change this system of trading, because we started the project too, because the coffee community, a roaster from the state, he was going to buy the harvest, and then the pandemic arrived, and he said, like, okay, I cannot buy the harvest, so sorry, and they were in risk to lose the harvest. When you are working with community supported agriculture, if you pre-buy the harvest, the farmers are already have part of the harvest already sold, so they are not worried of that, and they are not participating in this market. So I think we need to move from going from that. And there's a lot of projects in every part of the world. There are projects that you can buy to the farmers, and they deliver some fresh veggies in the week, and is the same.
Okay, how altitude do you have in you are situated?
This coffee is a high altitude coffee. This is why it's soft. It grows 2,500 meters high.
2,500
is really high. But the beautiful thing with coffee is that it's an excellent plant. It grows everywhere. So you can manage that. But yeah, I would recommend that if cacao is native from there, and you can have both. But if the communities were already growing cacao and the cacao had diseases, then you need to change the way that they grow that cacao and to start to working with regenerative agriculture. And then the cacao is going to be the saver, because it was not the problem of the cacao. It was the problem in how the cacao was growing.
Also we had a lot of cadmium in the soil. And I need to change the pH of the soil first. Mm-hmm. So I will do it with me. And I'm working also with biodynamic people that are fighting the same. So it's not biodynamic is not so expensive in order to change the soil, no? With cal, I don't know how you call cal in English, and you mash stones in order to have minerals to place in the. So you will not have only cadmium, but many other, you know, things to eat for the plant. So I am trying to think which is the easiest and the fastest thing to do in order to change the soil and in order to you know, other people to follow me. So I have to do it first with my field in order to to prove that is that it works.
I'd like to remind everyone that this is a training about creating a brand.
A brand, yes, okay, yeah, okay.
I know you have a lot of questions. No, it's fine. I understand you have a lot of questions, but
yeah.
We have another presentation now from Johanna in Brazil about the creating her brand. And I think if you want to ask more general questions about each other's projects, there's going to be, we're creating a new platform for you to be able
to That's perfect.
Do that.
Yeah.
So, Johanna, would you like to step in now? And thank you, Santi, for a really great presentation, and your project is so inspiring, and I'm really happy that you're doing.
No, thank you. And yeah, I think the next part is going to be really amazing. So take notes, because I think Johanna has a lot of beautiful things to say. So thank you, and I'm gonna be here.
Thanks, Santi.
Thank you, guys. I'm such a fan of Jaguar Siembra. I've stalked them before, and I love the image and everything. So it's really great to hear the story. We have a completely different kind of approach and story a little bit, because I guess our background was a little bit different. I'll talk to you guys a bit about Sinal quickly of what we do. Sinal is a camp that is like 200 hectares, and we are in the rainforest outside of Brazil. I'm still here. And the rainforest outside of Brazil, outside of Rio de Janeiro, sorry. I'm originally Mexican, but I've been living here for the past 5 years now. And basically, what we do is we work directly in the 200 hectares, but we also work as an influencer we basically act in the buffer zone between the last remaining protected areas of the Atlantic rainforest and the urban sprawl of Rio. So there, in that in between, there's a lot of pressure on biodiversity, a lot of informal occupation. And so there are a lot of the typical pressures that the urban sprawl will give to this forest that is already at 12% forest cover. So it's quite endangered. And the brand that we created is not really, I'm not going to talk about Sinal, but one of the solutions that we came up with, which is like a brand of jackfruit, green jackfruit. I don't know if you have ever seen the fruit or heard about it. But basically, one of the solutions that we came up with in the many different ways that Sinal acts was this idea of creating a brand for jackfruit, which is really what I'm going to talk about, how the process was of creating it. Share screen. Oh, okay. Sorry, guys, it's taking me a little bit long because I just updated my computer and it's asking me for all these permissions now. So I have to do that quickly. How do we do that? Oh, okay. There we go. Is everything okay? Oh, she's gone. Oh, she's back. Johanna? Internet issues.
Johanna, are you there? Hello.
Hello. Hi. I'm back. Sorry. It asked me to like restart Zoom and I just like went as fast as I could. So we're back.
Great.
Okay. So can you see my screen?
Yes.
Perfect. So as I was saying, well, Sinal really works creating a lot of different solutions for infrastructure problems and several like problems that come out of this pressure of the urban sprawl. And Madre was born, like Madre is the name of the brand, and it was born out of this intention to find a financially sustainable mechanism to regenerate the Atlantic rainforest. Because jackfruit is actually invasive. It's not really from Brazil, and it's dubbed invasive here. It just grows a lot. It's a very big fruit. It has a lot of seeds. So, and it really likes the conditions, the tropical conditions here. It's originally from India. And so it has spread all around the native forests of the area. And the way that the government has chosen to tackle this issue is by I don't know how you say this in English, by cutting a ring on the trees to cut the circulation of sap and killing the tree. The thing is that the jackfruit tree is very resilient, so it doesn't really work a lot. It's also expensive because you have to send a lot of people to these physically like go tree by tree by tree and cutting them out. And at the same time, it doesn't really take into account the fact that it still sinks carbon. The biodiversity already relies on this food source. And the interesting thing about jackfruit is that it's also, if you grab it green, it doesn't really taste like anything. And so you can use it as a substitute for meat, and it just allows for a lot of creativity. And so we decided to propose this counter proposal where it's like, well, what if we collect the green jackfruit that is already around? It's so abundant. And then we create this sort of like processing method that grabs every single different part of the jackfruit and sells it to vegetarian restaurants in Rio de Janeiro. And we'll, by creating like this entire value chain, then people who are like small farmers that are our neighbors can make a living out of selling these jackfruits. So we designed, there's a very technical aspect to it. We've designed this agroforestry model that is containing the jackfruit, but taking it away and processing it, and also inserting at the same time other native species like cupuaçu and jussara, which jussara is the acai of the Atlantic rainforest. And so basically that is the product that we use, that we had to create a brand for. And the biggest challenges were that, well, we had nothing. It was a brand that we had to come up with that is different from Sinal, because while it's a project of Sinal's, Sinal's ultimate mission isn't to sell jackfruit. So we had to come up with something else. And at the same time, it's not, jackfruit has kind of like a bad reputation in Brazil. So we had to come up with something to make it exciting and to make it new. And just to create a personality out of nowhere, basically. So the branding process was like this. I'd like to begin by saying that there's a big disclaimer. There's nobody at Sinal really who has a graphic design background or even a communications background. I myself, I'm the coordinator of communications, but that's not my background at all. I studied international relations and I used to work for the United Nations. I didn't really have any communications experience really at all. So hopefully that will give everybody some like peace, in the sense of if you guys don't have anybody in your team that has done this before, it's not the end of the world. And also the good news is that we are all really kind of trained, because we are all creative and we're all consumers of brands. So we all in a way have this possibility of stepping outside and looking at examples and thinking about what that means and how to create our own stories. So basically we said, well, how do we even begin to give a personality to our project. So we had this guy who was living here who had a designer background, but he didn't really work for our team. And he gave us some tips and helped us come up with an idea so that we could create a story around the whole jackfruit situation. And the first part was trying to think creatively and understanding our project, understanding our story, and thinking about how we could tell it to people. And then we looked at a lot of options of narratives and then chose one. And then we made our first basic materials to get going, which were like the sales presentation, the social media, and the labels, basically. So the getting creative. To get things going, we started interviewing everybody that had to do with the project at some point. Of like, everybody here at Sinal has technically a different job. I do communications. Somebody else does some sort of like coordination of the vivero of the nurseries, and somebody does the culinary aspect of Sinal. But then everybody at the same time is contributing to this project. And it was very important for us to interview everybody to get a feel of what everybody's perspective was, because everybody has a different approach within the project. For example, the person who collects the jackfruit has a completely different experience about it than the person who is cooking it, and then the person who is processing it, than the person who is telling the story. Everybody has sort of like a different association with the project, a different scent of like what it smells like, what it tastes like, what it what it means to talk to the owners of the farms from the jackfruit trees that we have to map. And so if you can track all of those stories and all of those like perceptions, then we create something that everybody's involved in and that you can see all the possibilities that there are to tell this story. So that's what we did first. We interviewed everybody, and we interviewed them with like three types of questions. I actually made a folder that I can share to Ashley, then she can share to you guys of these tools that might help you. Some of the questions are kind of like random questions of like, name a place, name an animal, to get a feel of how the person is coming in with their own personality. We did some association questions of like, if the project were a tool, what would it be? If the project were an organ, what would it be? And it's this whole idea of just getting people to think creatively about the project and think associated to any type of metaphor. And then some upfront questions about it of like, how do you see this business? And how do you see the people that we're selling to? And how do you see the team? What do you hope for in the future for this project? And then we just basically made an Excel sheet and put everybody's answers in there. And so what came out when we sort of looked at this and saw this repetitive constant of the concept of abundance, for example, in the sense that this project was created because we started thinking, okay, we should do an agroforestry model to create a source of income with minimum effort for people in the community, and at the same time, we're protecting the ecosystem. But then at first we started thinking, no, we're gonna plant this like red pepper that they like in France, and it grows here, and we can make start from scratch. And then in our thinking, we thought, well, there's jackfruit everywhere. There's so much jackfruit that it's actually sort of like, it makes more sense to think about like how to contain it than to think about like how we're going to create something new out of the blue. So coming in from this perspective of abundance, really what sort of like was in tune with everybody. And it was something that it made sense to include somehow in our narrative. And then at the same time, everybody in one way or the other talked a lot about interconnectivity, about like how we wanted to protect the environment, but help people have a source of income, but at the same time make something that was tasty. And that it had just a lot of different perspectives. And then that everybody talked a lot about the idea of bringing back this ancient wisdom instead of like not as capitalistic, not as a sort of like cutthroat, but more of this bringing back this indigenous sort of wisdom of the land here in Brazil, and that is repetitive across Latin America. And there was also this sort of like dichotomy in it, because people were sort of trying to bring back this ancient wisdom, but at the same time we were like, but we're new and we want people to know that this is how it is and that we just want to offer something different. So we had this sort of like, okay, these are some of the values and these are some of the concepts that are coming up. And at the same time, in terms of like sensations of people had this feeling of the brand that it should be very tropical, that it should be very Latin, which was interesting because we know that jackfruit is Indian, but at the same time, everybody was like, no, this should have a feel that is coming from Latin America as a solution. It's funny because jackfruit is very popular as sort of like a meat substitute in Germany and like Europe, but then Latin America, not so much yet. And so the idea was like, no, let's just bring this back to like this local, this local environment. And so at the same time, there was a sort of like this like lighthearted yet firm sort of sensation of like, oh, we want to be sort of like protecting the environment and all, but then at the same time, a little bit like, this is how it is and we need to solve climate change. And so how do you, the idea was like, okay, this is a lot of information. It's very abstract. So what do we do with this? And then we asked ourselves, well, if we had to reunite all of this into one personality or one person or one group, like who is like that, you know? And then we came up with the idea of a council of Latina matriarchs, of like a council of like women that are like older women, you know, they've seen stuff, they have this wisdom. And then the fact that they're, for example, very loving and very nurturing and very forgiving, but they're also kind of stern. I don't know, well, Santi is also Latin American, but I don't know if he agrees with me, but there's something about like the persona of a Latin mother that is kind of very loving and very warm, but at the same time, like you don't mess with mama, you know? So our idea was sort of like it sort of made sense. And then we started thinking about like how it meant to be, like everything that it possibly had to do with this personality. And one of them was also kind of like, there's this solemnity and this ancient wisdom and this whole like big persona, like idealistic persona, but at the same time, there's also like the gossip and the fun of it, you know? And so it really helped us to think about a personality, because it helped us create the colors and the languages, really, and the way that this entity that is being born is gonna talk about itself, you know, how it's gonna express itself in all possible ways. And so once we had this idea of the matriarchs, we had a weekend where we were like, let's just explore everything of getting a feel of what this means. And we used Pinterest, which I really recommend for the mood boards that Santi was talking about. We made a sort of like a mood board of Spotify, just listening to all the music, and of Netflix. So like, oh, what are some movies that we should watch about like these personalities to get a different feel of this? And so we made a mood board as well. We put a lot of different stuff in there. It's not just, we didn't just do, for example, thinking about other products that are similar, like Chocolate Ibarra, for example, that sort of like chocolate over there is like a brand of hot chocolate in Mexico, or Royal, which is like everybody's household has one. We were thinking also about like, what is a typical thing of like one of these businesses run by these women? Oh, in Latin America, and I think in India as well, I don't know if in other places, it's very common where you write on the wall the sort of like, oh, Cocina Económica, which is like economic kitchen, Lupe, and it has like the menu written on the wall, and there's a very specific, they use these shadows, and then also memes. This Jesús en la Boca is an expression in Mexican Spanish. I'm not sure if in other cultures in Latin America, where mothers say that a lot, like, oh, you had me with the Jesus in the mouth. It's like, I was so worried, and all these like feelings. So the mood board really reflects not only not only like the other brands, but aspects of this entire culture. That I don't know if you guys have seen the movie, what's it called in English? I think Coco, in the Pixar movie with the Dia de Muertos, and if you've seen it in the corner below to the right, there's the grandma of this character, and the grandma is such a like a typical character of what we wanted this brand to sort of look like, where she's like trying to force feed you food because she loves you and she thinks you're malnourished, and so she gives you like 5 tamales and she like has her shoe that she's threatening you with, and so this sort of like creating this mood board, not only about the visual aspects but the culture really. And the same with Spotify. We grabbed a lot of songs from different things in Latin America. The idea was thinking about like what would the voice of these women sound like? What would they sing about? What are the rhythms? And we used everything, Cuban sort of salsa and cumbia and samba. And so we would do the mood boards listening to that music and just try to be, you know, as immersed as possible in this like personality that we're creating. And that was a lot of fun. I really recommend that. And so after that, we went to the naming, which was basically a process of really, the idea is that any idea is welcome. The creativity should have no filter in that sense. So we made this open spreadsheet and we wrote the name, we just write the name, why you think it's a good idea, and then voting. And so everybody had some time to write their names and explain why. And then we went through voting rounds. And in the end, it's funny because one of the actual name that had originally won, which was Dope, which means sort of like, Dope is like right from the source of the tree. It's this play on words in Brazilian Portuguese, but it was already taken. So the next one that won was Madre. And Madre is interesting because Madre isn't the name for mother in Portuguese, that's mine. But Madre is sort of like understood in a way that is sort of like a more mother nature like. So we thought that was a great idea to sort of like encase the entire idea of the personality. And then from then we had a name, and then it was just a matter of like starting to break down some things that we had to choose, which were the typography and the colors and the language, sort of like, how would she speak? How would they speak? What are the things that she speaks about? And so that sort of like took us into the direction of thinking, okay, what are some of the characteristics and how can we tell the story in different ways of Madre? And we started by the logo, really. The logo, which to simplify things, we decided that our logo had to be the name of the company. We started experimenting with a lot of typographies, and in this presentation, I'm putting some resources that are pretty good that are free also of checking out typographies that you can download, like Google Fonts and stuff. And we started looking at some of the characteristics of each of the lettering. And this is interesting because again, we didn't really have a background on design. But then if you think about, if you train yourself to think about, like, for example, Coca-Cola is a brand that everybody recognizes. What is something that Coca-Cola always talks about in their ads and everything? It's not really about the drink. It's about friendship and it's about sharing. So why is the name Coca-Cola written in like these letters that are sort of cursive? Oh, because that is sort of like warm and has this personality. So if you look at other examples and you get a feel of why they chose that, maybe it gives you an idea of looking at these letters and thinking, oh, okay, I think this sort of engloba, this represents some of the qualities that this personality is trying to say. And so in the end, we had all these versions. We had this version that was more of like strong and the very like feministy. And then we had this other one that had to do with it more like a vintage kind of look. And then to the right is the one that we ended up choosing, which is really a typography that I'm going to show you, but we just inverted the colors and just used the shade of it. But basically what we liked best about it is that it's in a way, it's sort of like it's the same typography that would be like what they choose when you write in school, how they teach you to write, you know, well, but at the same time, it's like what this, like the badass guy will tattoo on his arm, like the name of his mother, you know, it has this dichotomy of being sweet, but at the same time, very strong. And we thought that it made sense in like the context of this personality. And then we thought about like how we really liked the whole writing on the wall of the business idea, in the sense of like, in at least in Latin America, the typical, there's a lot of like eateries that are like this one lady of a family where they just cook very homemade meals, and then you arrive there and you pay very little and you eat something that is very homemade style. So we thought, well, that sort of like also has to do with our brand. And also very importantly, it's very much the image of the Baixada Fluminense, where we are, the sort of periphery of Rio de Janeiro. It's not fancy and it's not premium. It's not trying to like pretend it's something it's not. It's sort of like urban. So in the end, we thought it just made sense. And we chose that one. And so we settled on the typography, which is Daywalker. It's called Daywalker. And it's always a good idea to have like two typographies. The main one that you use for headings and for accents, and the one that you use for actually writing on everything. If you pay attention, for example, to the Jaguar website, there's a typography for accents, and there's a typography for like all the text that doesn't really change, despite the fact that the drawings change, the art changes from package to package, the typography stays consistent and the colors stay consistent too. So that is very, very important. We also settled on the colors. We have two main ones, which is the yellow and the red. And that was because when we were doing the research, we realized that the vast majority of brands that have sell products that are sort of like in natura, in the sense that you cook them, that you use to spice something up, or that you use to create a meal, they're mostly those two colors that are very warm and they sort of like awaken the appetite. So we have those two primary ones, and the three complementary ones that are for accents. And we chose those because eventually this agroforestry project is gonna eventually start giving in a couple of years some more other fruits. So we're gonna have to expand our lines. So we're already creating this brand that is sort of, it's not this one product, but it might grow into other ones. So subconsciously, I guess we're trying to get the people, our clients, familiar with all these different products or how it's gonna feel eventually. And so for this, I have these two tools that are free and that are incredibly easy to use, that are Google Fonts. This is very good for searching, even with like ideas in mind. You know, I'd like something like handwriting, and you write handwriting and it shows you a bunch of options, and then you have like different ideas. So it's very easy to use. And then Canva is just amazing. It's great for if you don't really know, or you don't have anybody who knows Photoshop or anything complicated. It's super, super easy. It already has a thing to design to create logos, so it can help you decide and use a drawing or a type of typography. At the end of the day, sometimes we think we try to complicate things so much, but at Sinal we have to do things like with what we have and how we can, you know, and really the more simple that you make things, the better, when you're just starting out, and then you get more sophisticated. No, so I really recommend those two tools that are free, and they're also free. Canva has a free program for NGOs, that if you submit your request and you get it, you get the pro version, which is kind of like the bigger version for free. We have that, for example, for Sinal. So we work a lot with that, and anyone can use it. It's really great. But yeah, so those are the two fundamental things that we came up with. And then we came up with the materials that, like, the minimum materials that we needed to start selling the jackfruit. The first one is the brand manual, which is really very internal, but it's sort of like the Bible of the do's and don'ts, and like the colors and the typography for everybody who needs to create a material to use. Or if I myself leave Sinal or whatever happens, there's this that people know that is just the way it is with the brand of Madre Frutos. And then there's a sales presentation, which has the why, of course, the project vision, and then the products and the prices and the contact. The labels, which is, you have to, in our particular case, you have to work with a nutritionist, and it has the logo, but it's basically, it's quite simple. And the communication channels, which for us were Instagram and Facebook, because there's something very important. See, this brand is incubated within the larger project of Sinal, where a lot of things are happening at the same time. Right now we're building, we're expanding our processing plant, so Madre is growing. But then, you know, the daily challenges are like the building of the plant and that a fence broke and the cows escaped. So there's just a lot of different things going on, and really it makes more sense to start small and to build up what you can as you grow, because especially with communication channels, if you can't maintain what you've created, it loses its credibility. So it's better to start small. We use both Instagram and Facebook because they're linked, really. If we technically, it's pretty much like using one by itself. And again, Canva is also very, very helpful for creating communication for Instagram and Facebook. And the thing about creating a personality is that it not only dictates what the logo is going to look like, but it's going to dictate also what you're going to talk about on these social media, because you're not always going to post your products over and over again. You know, you also create this narrative. So if you sit down and you say, what would Madre talk about? What would this council of women talk about? Oh, well, we have like a lot of sayings, you know. My grandmother likes to say a lot of like sayings of, oh, better to have a bird. I can't think of any in English. I always have them in Spanish. But anyway, the important thing is that it gives you a lot of possibilities of creating interaction and creating messages and to create this familiarity with your clients. So this is why sort of like it gives you this, creating this robust idea that will give you even like the smallest, like day-to-day sort of messages. And well, so I have some final thoughts that creating really, as I was saying, needs no filter. It's better to just like say whatever reference is coming to your mind so that people all of a sudden think about it in a different way. It's the more that you can talk to your team and see the way that they respond and the way that they perceive the project, the better. And if it makes sense, and if this personality is something that all of a sudden makes sense to you, then that's a good track. It's good to have a help with somebody who has a design background, even if they're not involved in the project, just because they help you think. For example, in my case, they helped me a lot to think about, well, why do you think this typography is this way and not the other, you know? And so giving you a little bit of understanding of what you should look at when you're looking at colors and when you're looking at types of lettering and when you're looking at drawings, types of drawings, it really helps out. But it doesn't have to be, like, the person doesn't have to be involved necessarily in the entire process. Again, another thing is that when communicating the brand, the consistency is the key. It's true that organically it will evolve and people will give you feedback. And then as it grows in personality and as it grows a little bit in sort of confidence, it will become more alive, but there's a certain consistency that should not change, should be respected, which is basically like the logo and the colors and the typography is very important. It's kind of like the Jaguar example, where the artwork might change, but really the tracing of the drawings is pretty much the same aesthetic. It feels familiar to people, and the name, the typography of the name is also the same, and you know, it just gives this familiarity, and it slowly, even if you're changing things, it's slowly sort of like, no, we're still these, like, remember us, but and you go transforming as time goes on. And finally, well, I made a little bit of like a package with the things that we, with this presentation, with the things that we used, with a spreadsheet that you guys can use if you want to take some inspiration also from like interviews and how to interpret those interviews, that I'll send to Ashley, she can pass around. And we, again, just reiterate that here at Sinal, we're not specialists in communication, and we really just are very practical and do the best with what we have. But I'm very passionate about creating stories. So if you need like detailed advice on tools and resources and how to figure things out, I'd love to help out. So you can reach out.
Yay. Thanks so much. Both of those presentations were fantastic and really informative. And I can see from the chat that Yasmin and Margarita already have lots of new ideas as a result of your teachings. So thank you so much for your time in putting this presentation together. And I'm sure many of the other camp coordinators will see this recording too. And we'll have it on our YouTube channel under the camp trainings playlist, so that all of the camps, current and new, we'll have access to this information. So yeah, it was really worthwhile doing. And I'm really happy that we now have this recorded so that everyone can see it and learn from it in the future. I have to leave in about 20 minutes. So I think we can continue until then if there are any specific questions, both for Johanna and Santi. Let's try and keep the questions to about creating a brand, because if you have anything else you want us to do a training on, like marketing, packaging, etc., we can work on that. But seeing as this is a branding training, let's just talk about branding for now, and anything else you want to learn about, just let me know for future trainings. So Yasmin, seeing as this training was originally created for you, is there anything that you want to know about more?
Oh my goodness. I had the idea, but obviously the team have done so far, you know, so well, and, you know, especially branding their names, and how important just the kind of creating a logo and how important it is to have a story behind it, a type of storytelling, not just selling a product, but selling the branding itself. So that definitely inspired me, and especially the last presentation really captivated me. The aspect, you know, obviously it shows that, you know, how far I am at and how far I'm lacking as well. So this definitely came, the presentation came the right time. So I have to go back and think about the branding aspect of it, of the project. Yes, you know, the difference between the products that is being shown tonight and the one that we're, you know, that we're selling and we want to brand ourselves is again, this one is a wild treat, you know, it grows in the wild. It is one of the species that is considered to be threatened, so it has to be saved. Otherwise, people are afraid that internationally that we lose this tree. So we have to, and a lot of women do work in this area. and they're undervalued. So bringing the woman in and valuing the small scale the farmers themselves, and kind of giving a story to the of the product, not just selling the product that, that it comes from, but actually, you know, kind of creating a community awareness. And I think that's what I got out of it. Before I was just focusing on just putting the package and just getting the thing out. But we want to tell a story why it's important. If you want to buy that product, why would it be important to buy that product specifically from us, right? And we have to be able to connect the product to the community as well. And this was definitely a reminder. I would like to see this more, and I'll definitely reach out to the team to get their support as well if I need help. But I really appreciate it. This is like an awesome training. Thank you.
Cool. I look forward to hearing more, Yasmin, about some branding ideas for Camp Dryland Solutions. It would be really cool to see some initial ideas for your brand as a result of this. Are there any other questions or suggestions for future trainings or anything else that we wanted to talk about before we close?
I don't know how much, I will definitely go back again and watch it on YouTube as well. But I like to learn, you know, maybe have another discussion about this, the branding aspect of it, and maybe share share ideas as well. I don't know. But I like this one a lot.
Do you mean share your ideas?
Well, I could do that next time when I, you know, put everything together.
Uh-huh.
Yes, I can do the presentation as well.
That sounds good. I think rather than it being another training, though, maybe a branding working group could be created that the camps can join, and then anyone else who's also working on creating their brand, that could be a place where it's done collaboratively with other camps. In June we're launching our knowledge sharing platform, so I think that could also be a good place for discussions about branding to take place. So maybe let's wait until then. It's only a couple of months time, and then see if that platform is a good one for discussing this, and if not, then maybe I'll see if there's appetite for a working group about branding, for camps to come together and share ideas about creating brands, because there are other camps as well out there who have done it, who could be brought in to give their advice. Yeah,
I want to share something. I need to go too, but I wanted to share something before. And it's, yeah, Yasmin, more related for the process that you are living. I think like with all this information, sometimes it's a lot of information, and then the problem is that we don't know how to start. But I think it's like you need to focus into do it really simple. For example, even with the resources, we started to just with one bag of coffee. And then with the two bags of coffee. So the idea is to put something out and to start to testing. From there, as you see, the image is always evolving. So it's really hard to go from a concept and then to have everything done. But you could start with even without selling your product, without packaging or without a logo or without something like that. But it's a journey, so step by step. But yeah, I think it will be great for you just to watch this again, to research, who always ask for help. Maybe someone knows a graphic designer that will be willing to volunteer in your project. And yeah, keep going until you make it. So I think you don't get unmotivated for the amount of things that that we need to do to create a brand. It's just to put in the first stone and from there start to flowing.
I agree with what Santi said, Yasmin. I think some good steps forward that you can do now is to create a mood board, which is basically a collection of different images and colors and letters and things that you think represent your purpose and the feeling that you want people to have when they buy your products. But even before that, like Johanna said, have a conversation with some people that you want to be involved in your camp and ask them how they feel about frankincense. And also have a think about who you would sell the product to. These are all things that I think could be done now to give you ideas. And then once you have the thoughts and opinions of people, then you can start finding other images that have the same sort of, that conjure up the same sort of feeling that you want to conjure up with your brand, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and for example, I'm going to show you something. Like there is a lot of projects and even coffee projects and big brands or whatever that I started with something really simple. Like this is a seal that you can make really cheap. Like if you focus into just only have a name, even write it with some nice typography, and then you have a little bag with something and you put your seal, then you have a brand, and then you could start to sell it in markets or with local things or with simple things like that. And even right now, is a lot of people love that it's even hand-grated or that is not a super image well made. We started with this actually to start to sending the proofs that we have from the coffee from different people and to chefs, to locals, to start like that, and with a little note grated by us by hand. And this was the starting of everything, and then we started to evolve. So sometimes we overcomplicate too much just to start, and if you already have a product that you already have, it's just finding the way to put it out.
Absolutely. No, I agree with you. Sometimes it's the obstacles, you just kind of getting things started and getting a brand out. And that is definitely that support to see other, someone like you guys who are, created a brand that looks fantastic. You know, it looks so great. So inspired, really appreciate it.
Cool. Amigos, I need to go, but thank you very much for everything. It was lovely to share these things to you. Thank you, Ash. Thank you, Johanna, and everyone that was here, Margarita, and the rest. So I hope to see you soon again. I'm going to send you the campaign soon as we launch it in the WhatsApp group, and I'm going to share how it's going to, or our new design is going to look like. So have a wonderful day and night wherever you are. And let's keep in touch.
Thank you, Santi. Thanks so much.
Dale. Thank you so much to all of you.
Ciao.
I'll see you. Okay.
I think maybe now
okay.
It's time
bye-bye.
To end the training. So thanks everyone for coming.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye. Bye.